this session is all about API security. So when it comes to API security, so we need to think about the audience first. So who are going to be the audience of our API? The API can be a public API, or it can be a private API. Then again, this API can be accessed by a user himself. So basically, I'm the owner of the resource. I'm going to access my resource as myself through the API. The other use case is there can be an application accesses your API on behalf of a user. So there are two use cases. So first, so in this session, basically, I'm covering generic API security practices, patterns and practices, and where appropriate, I'll relate it to WSO2 platform. So first, let's worry about direct authentication. So this means I am the owner of the API. I'm going to access it as myself. So there are a few ways that you can secure the API. The most common used one some time back when you secure APIs is HTTP basic code. So even today, if you go to GitHub, so if you try to create a repository through its API, so you are the owner of that particular repository. So you are going to create it for yourself. So you just pass your username and password in the HTTP authorization header, and you can create your own API. So now, so if you want to do this with WSO2 API manager, so out of the box, we do support OAuth-based secrets. So we'll talk about that later. If you want to do this, you can still, so we have a handler for basic code. So simply, you can engage that handler to your API, and then you can pass your username and password over the HTTP authorization header. So there are disadvantages of this pattern, so let's discuss those stuff as we go on. The alternative to the basic code is to use digest authentication. So the difference between basic code and digest auth is, in basic code, you are basically sending out your password over the wire. So it has to be secured with transport level security. So basic code must be over TLS. With digest auth, you never put your credentials on the wire. So basically, you use some sort of signature mechanism based on a particular it's basically a hashing algorithm. And based on that, you only send the hash or the digest over the wire. But if you want to support digest authentication at the server side, there are certain steps you need to take. If it is basic code, since you are just sending username and password over the wire, we can validate the user against the stored credentials. And we don't need to store the user's password in clear text in our user store. So we basically store a salted hash. Because we don't need to have the clear text password. We get the user's clear text password. We calculate the hash. Then we compare that hash with the salted hash what we have stored in the user store. But in digest authentication, so digest authentication need not to have the TLS or the transport level protection. You are not sending any credentials over wire. So you simply send a hash of username, password, and realm. Right? So it includes some other parameters too, but ideally it's around username, password, and realm. So now if we want to calculate, validate this hash, we need to store the password at our side. We cannot store the hashed password at the user store side. It should be clear text, or it can be encrypted. But if you even you encrypt it, but still, the who owns the encryption key can decrypt and see what the password is. So to alternative that is, you can hash username, password, and realm, and then store that hash in your user store. So to support digest auth, it has to come from the identity store too. So I explained some differences. Another main difference is, so with basic code, you can only achieve authentication to find out who the user is. With digest auth, so there's something called quality of property parameter. So with that, if you set auth int there, so that will support both authentication as well as integrity of the message. So the complete HTTP entity body will be signed. Or basically, we calculate the MD5, against the complete HTTP entity body if you put oath in. So with basic oath, you cannot achieve integrity, but if you use digest oath, you can do that. Then the other approach is just use TLS mutual authentication. This is once again for direct authentication and mostly used when you have a trusted subsystem. So in this particular example, so end user authenticates the web application with some way, right? It's not related to API. API doesn't need to know about the end user's details. Once web application authenticates the user, if it wants to retrieve certain data from the backend APIs, so that channel can be just secure with certificates. So for the API application server or the API, the web app is a trusted subsystem. Then the other approach is two-legged OAuth. And with two-legged OAuth, so this comes with OAuth 1.0. So OAuth 1.0 is almost obsolete. Only Twitter uses it at the moment. So hopefully they'll migrate as well. With two-legged OAuth, so in three-legged OAuth, what you see most of the time on the web, there are three parties involved: a client, resource owner, and the authorization server, right? Or the resource server, right? So for example, if you log into TweetPic, and if you want to tweet a photo, what you do is you upload the photo to the upload the photo.tweetpic, then you will be redirected to the Twitter. You create a temporary token and hand it over to TweetPic. So TweetPic is the client. I am the user. I'm the owner of the resource, and Twitter is the resource server. So now using that temporary token, TweetPic or the client can access my Twitter API on behalf of me and tweet the photo. Right. With two-legged OAuth, we have only two entities. Client becomes the resource owner. So I'm basically accessing my API. So in this case, so you have the consumer key and consumer secret, and you are using a signature-based mechanism. You never pass your client ID over the wire, right? So if you are familiar with OAuth 2.0, the equivalent profile is MAC token profile for OAuth 2.0, but still it's under development. It hasn't come to the mainstream yet. Then comes the OAuth 2.0. So this is the de facto standard for securing API. So if you plan any API project fresh, then you need to use OAuth 2.0. Because this is going to be like enterprise standard, industry standard for securing APIs. And many vendors, they do support API security with OAuth 2.0. So with the difference between OAuth 1.0 and 2.0 is OAuth 1.0 builds a specific standard for a specific problem. Right? OAuth 2.0 is an authorization framework. It's not a concrete standard. OAuth 1.0 is a concrete standard. OAuth 2.0 is an authorization framework. So if you want to have the same behavior as in OAuth 1.0, in OAuth 2.0, what you do is you need to have a develop an OAuth 2.0 grant type to support the same behavior as in OAuth 1.0, right? So it's highly extensible. So you can almost do anything what you need. So it's highly recommended that you go for OAuth 2.0 if you start with an API project fresh. So OAuth 2.0 comes with four grant types. One is the authorization code grant type, which is you usually see. So if you want to log into a web app through Facebook, then it's OAuth 2.0 or authorization code grant type. And there's another flow called implicit grant type. This is mostly used for like untrusted clients, like single-page web applications, mobile applications, like public clients. Then the client credential grant type, this is similar to basic oath, right? Even you look at the sample message, this is very much similar to basic oath. You are simply sending client ID and client secret in the basic oath header. So this was developed to help people who were using basic oath to use or to migrate to OAuth. So that's why the client credential grant type was introduced. So this can be used in a case if you are the owner of the resource and you want to access it you can use client credentials. So this we do support in API Manager. So once again, we had a use case. So one of our clients, they had a requirement where, so you log into your Windows domain, and you have a web app. You want to access APIs without further providing any credentials. Because you already authenticated the system. So that's through Kerberos authentication system. Now you should be able to exchange this Kerberos token to get an access token. So this is the beauty in the OAuth specification. You can extend it. So we wrote a Kerberos NTLM grant type to support that. You pass the Kerberos ticket, validate it, and you get back the access token. Since then, the flow is same. So that's about direct authentication. And there are a few other things. So one thing is, so out of the box, when we issue an access token, it's an arbitrary string, right? It's a random string that we generate. And that access token represents the application and also the end user, right? Who gives the consent to access his resources on behalf of him. So this access token is opaque to the client, right? Client should not try to understand what's in the access token. You simply pass the access token along the API request. It hits the gateway. Then the gateway will talk to the key manager to validate the access token, right? So there's another type of access token. So that's called self-contained access tokens. So you can do that with API Manager, but you need to write a custom handler. So the way to generate this access token, that logic is extensible. So you can write your own extension and plug that into the key manager. So the self-contained access token is basically a JSON web token or JWT. Right? So why it is self-contained? That means the resource server or the gateway can validate that access token even without talking to the gate. To the key manager, right? So it includes user details. So this is the user, this is the client, and the scopes associated with the client and the request. And also, it is signed by the key manager, right? To sign JSON payloads, there are two standards. One standard for signing, that's called JWS, JSON Web Signature, and to encryption, that standard is called JSON Web Encryption, or JWE. So once you pass a signed JWT, so you base64 encode it, pass to the end user as an access token. Now you pass the access token along with the request, and it hits the API gateway. It's a normal OAuth request. Now API gateway can validate that token without talking to the key manager. So that has a benefit, like, so it includes signature validation, but then again, you cut down the transport cost. And there's another concept call. So this is called self-contained. So if you are using the trusted subsystem pattern, like in this scenario, we are use TLS, mutual load. Another approach is you can use self-contained, self-issued access tokens, right? So that means you simply generate the JWT by yourself. You sign the JWT, right? And then you send it over the wire authorization bearer header, just like a normal access token. And if the application server or the API trusts your certificate, then it can be validated since it is a self-contained JWT. Right? So this is mostly useful. Like we had a scenario in EC2, we couldn't use TLS mutual load. Right? It was terminated at the front. Right? The user information, certification information, those are not propagated into the downstream applications. So if you use this approach, we can do that. We are simply sending HTTP header. So this will go into the downstream applications. So you can validate the signature of the JWT. Okay. So that's all about direct authentication. Then the brokered authentication. So I'll explain this pattern by going through the arrows. So you have a web app, right? So the end user first logs into the web app. And this web app is configured to talk to a IDP or SAML, right? Basically to facilitate single sign-on. Now, user will be redirected to the SAML 2 identity provider in step 2, and then user will be prompted to authenticate. So I authenticate. If I am not already authenticated to IDP, then I need to give my credentials and authenticate. Then this IDP will issue a SAML token, right? That is in step 2. So now user is happily logged into this web app, right? Now it's working there. Now the web app needs to access a backend API on behalf of this user, right? So the keyword here is on behalf of this user. If it is not on behalf of this user, then you can use client credential grant type or any other security protocol to support trusted subsystem. But in this case, that API call should be invoked on behalf of the end user. So now this API is secured with OAuth. So you cannot access that API without an access token. But only thing you have is a SAML token. You can exchange this SAML token by talking to the authorization server, right? So if you look at this diagram, so this is a distributed setup. So I have one server as the IDP, another server as the OAuth authorization server. But in practice, this can be the same server, right? So now the web app has to talk to the authorization server, which is trusted by the resource server or the API gateway to get an access token, right? Now you can pass the SAML token to the authorization server using the SAML grant type 0020, so that this we do support, and then it will validate the SAML token. So there are two steps in validating the SAML token. The first one is it will validate the signature of the SAML token, right? So this request will only succeed if the authorization server trusts the SAML 2 IDP, because that SAML token is signed by the SAML 2 IDP, right? So if once the signature validation is done, then the authorization server will check whether this is a SAML token issued to me, right? So that check is done by looking at the audience restriction element in the SAML token, right? So that means if you want to support this pattern, you should tell SAML to IDP there, when you issue me an access token, the audience restriction element there should include a URI for me, that's a web app, and also another restriction element for the authorization OAuth authorization server. Otherwise, it will fail. Or else, the authorization server should check the same URI of the web app to pass it, right? So this is all we do support. So now, once that check is done, it will exchange the SAML token to an access token, and that will be returned to the web app. And in step 5, web app can use the access token to access the API. So that will go through the gateway, and the gateway once again will talk to the authorization server to validate the access token. Okay. So now, if we extend this pattern, right? So we have internal user and external user, right? So the scenario we discuss, let's say that's for internal user, right? So internal user comes here, the first diagram. So you can see the SAML IDP is connected to corporate Active Directory, right? So you just type your credentials, then you can authenticate. But there can be two audiences. So one is internal user, another user can be external user. So if internal user comes to the IDP in the first request, in the second arrow here, he can just enter his username and password, right? Since it's an internal user, we know how to authenticate that user. That user's credentials are in the LDAP, the corporate LDAP. But if it's an external user, right? So I think Isabel mentioned in her talk, like how to integrate Facebook authentication with the API gateway, right? So this external user can come from Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, or external SAML IDP, right? In this example, it says the user comes from SAML IDP. So what you can do is, if you use identity server here as the key manager, so you are redirected to the identity server, then in the identity server, we can give multiple options to login, we can have a link to the user's home IDP or Twitter, Facebook. So now you click on your home IDP, you'll be redirected to your own IDP, you authenticate there, you get a SAML token. Right? In this case, you get a SAML token which is signed by the external domain. Right? So now our IDP will validate the signature of the SAML token and it will issue a new SAML token. And this new SAML token is signed by our IDP and this SAML token will be passed to web app. So then it goes to the same scenario as before. So you have a SAML token from the IDP you trust, then you exchange it to an access token, authorization server. So authorization server is internal and that trusts the internal IDP. So there's no issue. So you validate the signature, then you issue the access token. Right. Then the same thing, same pattern, but here instead of SAML, we use JWT. So this pattern is useful if you authenticate your web app or if you log into your web app using OpenID Connect. Right? So with OpenID Connect, what you get is a JWT. And if you want to access an API after that, then there should be a way to exchange that JWT to an access token. So the same flow as before. Yeah. Then how do we integrate fine-grained access control with APIs? Right? So what happens is, so you can use any grant type. You can use SAML grant type, authorization code grant type, implicit password, or client credential, anything. Ultimately, what you get is an access token, right? So in all, there are two phases. The first phase is using any grant type, you get the access token. Then using that access token, you access the APIs, right? So now let's assume, so we have passed step three. Now you have an access token, right? Then you access the API in step four through the web app, and it hits the gateway, right? So gateway doesn't know anything about this access token, right? So it has to talk to the key manager to understand what's in this access token. And there's a profile called introspection profile. So this is developed under OAuth working group under IETF, and it became an RFC last week, right? So we are supporting introspection profile. So the API gateway can talk to the key manager through introspection profile, right? So you just pass the access token in a standard message. Then in response, what you get is the access token, the subject, then the scopes of the access token, and then the client ID, and also the audience restriction associated with this access token. So you get all these details in the introspection response, that's a standard response from the key manager. So since we support these standards, this is why you can integrate WSO2 API manager even with external key managers. It need not to be the identity server or in WSO2 product. You can integrate with any other key manager which supports the introspection profile. If it doesn't support introspection profile, but you still want to integrate with an external key manager, then we have an extensible architecture there. You can write a connector there to their proprietary API to validate the access token. Right. So now you get the introspection response. Using introspection response, you can build a SACML request. So SACML is the de facto standard for fine-grained access control. Right. So once you build a SACML request, you can send it to a SACML PDP. So a WSO2 identity server is a SACML PDP. Then it evaluate the request against the SACML policies defined, and it will pass back the response. And if it's permit, then the API gateway will let the user access the API. If it is denied, then it will block it. Right? So this shows a sample message, the introspection. So you send a request to the introspection endpoint. So you simply send a token here, the request. And in the response, you get this one. Whether the token is active, client ID, then the scopes associated with this token, then the subject and the audience. Right? So now, the resource server, the gateway, can authorize the user based on these parameters. Right? So this is the SACML high-level architecture. So you have the policy decision point where these decisions are taken. Policy administration point is a place where you write SACML policies. Then those will be get stored here. then PEP is the gateway. All the requests will hit or intercepted by the PEP. Then it will create a SACMAL request and talk to the PDP. Then PDP will evaluate the request against the policies defined. And in case if you find any missing information in the request, then it will talk to the policy information point to get those information from the corresponding data stores. So this is a sample SACMAL request. So you can see here, so I define my own category, right? So this I define my own category, and I put the client ID here. Then I put the action here. So you, since you are the gateway, you know the action. Then you can put the resource and also you can put the scopes here, right? So once you send this request to the PDP, you can define a policy there. So how to do fine grain access control based on these parameters. Okay. So another important pattern is change grant type. So you have the end user. So end user get an access token from the key server. Then you access a resource, right? So it goes to the service. Then that service needs to access another service, right? That is also protected with OO2. So how to do that? So to do that, you can use a chain grant type. So this is not with the product yet, but we have done similar implementations to different clients in custom way. So if you have any requirements on this, so please let us know. So this is still a draft spec. So there are still discussions going on, like how to do this chain grant type or chained access types with OO2O. The way it works with the chain grant type is the first server, the first resource server, get the access token. So now you have an access token. Then it will send a request to the token endpoint of the key server, passing that access token. And you need to set this as the grant type and not a scope, right? This scope has to be the same as the original scope or a subset of that scope. Then you will get back the access token. So now you can use this access token to access the downstream APIs. OK. Yeah. So we have 2 minutes. So this is a use case. How many of you have heard of UMA or user managed access? Great, yeah. So this is about UMA, where you have a centralized authorization server to control multiple distributed resource servers, right? Say, for example, I have my photos in Flickr. I have my friends in Facebook, right? So I maintain my calendar in Google, right? Now, if somebody wants to access my Google calendar, then I need to go to Google and say yes. So let him access my calendar on behalf of me. If somebody wants to access my Facebook friend list, then I need to go to Facebook and tell, OK, let him access my friend list on behalf of me. Same if I want to share my photos from Flickr. So this is the problem solved by UMA. So UMA is still new. It's getting attention. It will take some time. So we have implemented UMA spec as a GSOC project. So it's with us. So it'll take some time to get it to the mainstream. So, but I'll explain the flow. So the way it happens is the Facebook, Flickr, Google, all are resource servers, right? So that is what represented in this diagram, right? These are resource servers. And this is a centralized authorization server. So I need to manage authorization for Facebook, Google, and Flickr all through this my authorization server. So this is a profile developed on top of OO2, right? So what happens here is, first I need to log into my resource server, and I need to introduce my centralized authorization server, right? This is a one-time thing. So I need to log into Facebook. So if Facebook supports UMA, then I can tell Facebook this is my authorization server. Same for Flickr, and same for Google. So after that is done, resource server will talk to the metadata endpoint of the authorization server and get all the metadata related to authorization server, right? So that metadata response will include different endpoints, right? The first thing you need to do is you need to register this resource server, or Facebook has to register with the authorization server as a client, right? OAuth client. To do that, there's a profile call OAuth dynamic client registration profile, right? So API Gateway supports that. So using that profile, you register as a client in the authorization server, and you get back a client ID and client secret, right? Then using this client ID and client secret, resource server will redirect the user, resource owner, to the authorization server. And resource owner will authorize resource server to access the authorization server on behalf of that user. This is a one-time thing. Then you get an access token back. This access token is called PAT, or Protection Access Token. So this access token is good enough to access this protection API, right? Now the resource server will use this PAT to publish all its resources to protection, to using the protection API to the authorization server. So that will include, these are my APIs, and these are my scopes associated with these APIs, right? So all the resource servers will do that, right? Whenever a new API added, resource server will publish that to the authorization server. Now the resource owner can log into the authorization server and can define access control policies. It can say who can access these resources, right? I can say anybody can access my Facebook friend list. Likewise, I can give define different authorization policies. So that is done. That's the initial setup. Then this is my client, right? This is a client tab. So this is the user. User tries to access my resource, let's say Facebook friend list, through this client. So initially, it will try to access this resource without sending any authentication headers. Then this protected resource will send a response back saying, go to this authorization server and get a RPT, right? That is a requesting party token, right? So that response will include those details. Then client will, so if the client is not registered with the authorization server, once again, you need to use a dynamic client registration profile and register. Then you will redirect this user to the authorization server, get user's approval, and then you will get a RPT, right? The RPT is just another name to the access token, right? Now using this access token, you will try to access the resource. Now it will check whether this user has a right to access this resource by talking to the authorization server. If the user doesn't have the rights, then it will send back a response saying it will include a token ID, present this token ID to the authorization server, and get a access token that is good enough to access these resources. Now it will send this, it will access the authorization server once again using this AAT, passing the token ID, and then the authorization policies defined by the resource owner will get executed. It will check whether this user should be able to access the APIs or not. If it is fine, then it will issue another RPT which is good enough to access these resources, and the client can access the resources using that access token. Yeah. So that's basically it. So there are a lot of things happening in the API security domain. So I'll be around here today and tomorrow. So if you have any questions, please let me know. Thanks.